Life is a mysterious thing. As far as we are currently aware, Earth is the only place in the universe where life exists. Life is so prevalent on Earth because of a combination of many factors, including Earth's distance from its star. It is situated in the solar system's Goldilocks zone, in a region that is not too hot or too cold. We also have a magnetic field that protects us from solar and cosmic particles. We have an oxygen-rich atmosphere which we can breathe. We also have an abundance of water on the surface. These and a few other factors combined allow life to exist as it does here. But a quick look around the solar system reveals nothing on the surface of any celestial body that is even close to resemble the green and blue, lush surface of Earth. So does this mean there is no life in the solar system? Well, the simple answer is, we don't know. But there are a few places we are still interested in checking out, just to be sure. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum, and together we will travel through the solar system and see where the most likely places to find life could be. Here's our Sun. It's a very nice and stable type of star known as a G-type main sequence star. Not a good place to look for life, as far as we know though. Certainly nothing like life on Earth could survive the thousands of degrees temperature on the surface. We would have to expand our concepts of what life could be. Perhaps beings of energy rather than traditional elements. Neil deGrasse Tyson said he wasn't opposed to this idea.
I don't see why not, except, by the way, mass is energy. Energy is mass. So I can imagine an alien species that is energy. I can imagine it.
Like a pound of energy.
I can allow my brain to accept the possibility.
However, the possibility is extremely remote, so I think we can leave the Sun and move safely on to Mercury. Mercury does not tick many boxes in regards to what would be needed for life to form. It has a very tenuous atmosphere and is far too close to the Sun. This combination means that the temperatures on the day side rise to over 400 degrees Celsius and the night side can drop as low as -170 degrees Celsius. It has been discovered that Mercury was geologically active in the past, but the last eruption was thought to be 1 billion years ago. Many extinction events would have happened during Mercury's history that would have most likely prevented life from getting anywhere. There is water ice to be found in the permanently dark craters around the planet's poles, but we theorize that only liquid water can support life. Mercury seems to be a dead, inactive, and sterile planet. The next place to visit is Venus. Venus does have a rather substantial atmosphere, but the problem is that it isn't quite far enough away from the Sun to be in the Goldilocks zone. On Venus's surface, it is even hotter than Mercury, well over 400 degrees Celsius all over the planet. This is due to the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide make it up 96% of it. This heat means that water could not stay in liquid form on the surface. There is a slight possibility, however, that there could be some form of microorganisms high in the clouds of Venus that would use UV light from the Sun as an energy source. The temperature and pressure high in the atmosphere is much more hospitable than on the surface, so this possibility exists. But moving on, one of the best bets in the solar system is Mars. It is situated nicely in the Goldilocks zone and has an atmosphere. The big problem with Mars, though, is its lack of a magnetic field. The magnetic field on Earth prevents the solar wind from the Sun stripping away the particles in the upper atmosphere. Because Mars doesn't have this, its atmosphere has been stripped of all but the heaviest molecules, consisting of 96% carbon dioxide. At one point in its history, it did have some surface water, as can be evidenced by dried up rivers and lake beds. However, today that water has gone. And if there was any life on the surface, this is most likely gone too. Scientists have been keen to find evidence in rocks with the Viking missions, and looking for methane in the atmosphere with the rovers currently on the planet, but they have so far found only traces of evidence. But NASA are not deterred. Finding solid evidence of life on Mars is now one of their primary objectives, so they clearly think there's still a good chance of finding something. There are a few telltale signs that life exists or could have existed on Mars. There are possible biosignatures like methane in the atmosphere, often the byproduct of life. Scientists can't quite agree on where the quantity of methane gas comes from, and life is a definite possibility. We also have 34 meteorites on Earth which originated from Mars. These are highly valuable as they are the only samples of Mars that we possess. A few of these meteorites even contain what looks to be fossilized bacteria, although they are much smaller formations than any terrestrial bacteria on Earth. Sadly, this is not conclusive evidence, as these formations could also be explained by natural processes. At this point in time, there are a couple of possible places to find life on Mars. One would be about 10 meters under the surface. Water can be in liquid form this far down, and any life would be much more protected from cosmic and UV radiation. The other theory is that microorganisms could exist under the polar ice caps. Potential evidence of this could be the darkening of these spider patterns next to the geysers on the poles. The darkening could be these microorganisms as they photosynthesize the sun's UV light from under the surface. But with all the attention Mars is getting from the global scientific community, I guess that we will know conclusively whether there is life on Mars within the next 30 years. The possibility of life outside of Earth opens up a host of possibilities and interesting thought experiments about the cosmos. Brilliant.org has an astronomy course specifically about worlds beyond Earth, where you can actively grapple with puzzles and problem solving to deeply understand the Goldilocks zone that I mentioned in this video, how we can discover exoplanets around other stars, and a host of other thought-provoking questions. My videos tend to explain the facts about space, and Brilliant explains how we know these facts are true using maths and physics. By actively engaging with problem solving around this topic, you'll gain a much deeper understanding of what you see in my videos, which is why they are a great fit for you. If you go to brilliant.org/astrum, you can sign up for free, and by using that link, the first 200 people will get 20% off the annual Brilliant premium subscription. That's the subscription I've been using. And there we have all the terrestrial planets. Next time we'll look at the outer solar system and see the potential places for life there. If you enjoyed the video, like and share, as it really helps me make more videos in the future. And finally, check the comments for a little update from myself. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.